morning, Mayo.
Well, good morning. How are you?
I am so delighted to be here at Rose Hill with you. This is such a beautiful facility. It's heaven, Mayo. I know you have to come out here some days and just sit and just, you know, there's no other cares in the world when you're sitting out here in these rocking chairs on this porch. And we're here right now at the home that you were born.
Yeah, we
made
a few alterations since the time I was born here in 29. But it is a great old place, and the thing that we enjoy is having other people enjoy it.
Now, this place was actually came about around
1762.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so your family inherited this from Nathan Boddie.
That's right. He had a son, George, and then George had a son, George, and on down the line. And then my grandmother, she was she inherited it or turned over to her. She was born during the Civil War.
Okay.
And so probably in the late 1800s or something.
Now, how long did you live here?
Not long, because the Depression hit in about 29, really, when I was born. So we probably left in about, I was probably about 3 years old when we left.
And you moved to various places in Rocky Mount.
We moved in a little small house that's there now between Nashville and Rocky Mount.
Okay.
And all I remember, Daddy had a cow and we had chickens. And I think Mother, we'd go to the Kerr Market, you know, selling the chickens. But I remember Daddy said that he couldn't find a job making a dollar a day. And later on, I don't remember he really had a job when we lived there. But later on, we moved into Rocky Mount, and I think he got a job with the state. Exactly what it was, I don't know.
Now, you met Jean, your lovely bride, in high school. In elementary school,
elementary
actually.
School,
you went to school with her just about your whole life.
From the sixth grade, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then you started dating.
Yeah, started dating a little later in about the 11th grade. And I was busy with motorcycles and motorbikes. I didn't even want a date. And my mother told me I had a date.
Got a date.
So I called Jean, got a date.
Wow. And the rest was history, I guess. Yeah.
62 years later, we're still married.
62 years.
Yeah.
Wow. And she's a wonderful
three children,
lady.
9 grandchildren, 4 great-grandchildren.
Wow.
So it's been a good run.
So now, you were going to college.
Yeah.
But you figured that wasn't for you.
Well, it wasn't. And let's see, Christmas of, I'm trying to think what Christmas it was, in 50, I think, yeah. I decided I was going to join the Navy because the Korean War was going on, and I didn't want to go in the Army, so I came home to join the Navy. And Jean suggested that I get in the Naval Reserve and we get married. And I said, I ain't thought about getting married, I didn't have a job.
Right.
But we did.
But you got married.
Yeah. And she was making $35 a week. And
where was she working?
She's working commercial credit.
Commercial credit. Okay.
And then we came home, had about 3 days, what we call a honeymoon, I reckon. And she came home and got laid off. So that's when I told her, we put my arm around her and told her we didn't have but one way to go, and that was up. So she said, she stuck with me.
She's 62 years later, she's still
years.
With you, Mayo.
Yeah, 62 years.
So you got married, she got laid off, all of that.
I was a fireman on the railroad for about a year.
Okay.
When my father died, he had a small fuel oil business.
Okay.
So I ran that for about 2 years, and I decided that wasn't what I wanted to do. So I sold that, and I went to work for a trucking company. Went to work for a lumber company, really, $4 to $5 a week. And then I left there and went to work for a trucking company. What I was doing, I wanted to be in business for myself, but I didn't know what I wanted to do.
Okay.
So working for the trucking company, I was solicited in business. So that was good because I traveled Virginia, North Carolina, and I got exposed to different businesses, and that's what I wanted to do. So I stayed there a couple of years, and I opened a gas pump. Then I had three of those.
So you had three service stations. Where were they located?
Two laundromats.
Two laundromats.
Yeah.
Okay. Where were the service stations located?
One was at Douglas Corner.
Okay.
One was on Oil Church across from where Carolina Restaurant used to be. And one was in Roanoke Rapids. But then in 61, we bought the first franchises for Hardee's. So that's when I sold my stations and got out of that.
So Leonard Rawls and Jim Gardner opened up.
Well, they bought Wilbur Hardee had one in Greenville.
Okay.
And Leonard was a CPA. And Leonard was keeping his books and saw he was doing real well, so he got Jimmy and they approached Wilbur Hardee about buying in with him, and that which they did. Then they opened the one in Rocky Mount, down where the Jack Lockery Memorial Park is now.
Okay.
And then after they opened that, Wilbur wanted to get out, I think, so they bought Wilbur out. And that's when we bought our franchise, and Joe Brewer bought some, and Jack Bailey bought
Where
some.
Were your franchises that you bought?
In Fayetteville, or Kinston, and I believe Roanoke Rapids.
Mm-hmm. There's
we
nothing
three.
That smells any better than a char-broiled Hardee's hamburger.
Yeah, they were good. I mean, when we first got into Hardee's, we only had five products: hamburger, cheeseburger, french fry, milkshake, and drink. And now we have numerous products.
Oh, yes, you do. Now, how many Hardee's do you have now?
We have about 335.
Wow.
Yeah.
Now, the Carlton House, I believe the Boddie Noel offices were in the Carlton House originally in a little room.
We were the offices for the Hardee's, Boddie Noel.
Uh-huh.
It was in a laundry room upstairs. Yeah, that's where they were.
Wow.
And we stayed there probably 5 years. And then we moved on Sunset, the building there where United has just moved into.
Right, right.
And then after that, we moved over where we are now.
Right,
you built it. Hill.
Now, the Carlton House, of course, is named the Carlton House because your Uncle Carlton, Noel, had, a lot of lot to do with that, too. He was still, y'all were still in business with him.
And my aunt, his wife, she really had a lot to do with wanting to do it and wanting us to get into Hardee business. She was a business lady, and she was very instrumental in all of it, really, and wanting us to do it, encouraging her. Of course, she didn't. Nobody really had to encourage me much to do anything because I was just ready all the time to do something.
Right. Well, that's the reason you wanted to get out of college, I think, because your mind was always thinking and wanting to do things, and you knew you wanted to be an entrepreneur.
Yeah.
You knew from day one that you wanted to be in business for yourself, didn't
That's
you,
right.
Ned?
Yeah.
I always wanted to do
so
that.
So I didn't see the need in me sitting there for 4 years and majoring in history.
Right.
Some people it's fine, but I just didn't feel like it would suit me.
Right.
Because being in business for myself, I knew as soon as I had to get out, and it was going to take a while to find out what I could get into that would be profitable enough that I'd want to stay into it. And I had hoped I could start a business that when my boys grew up, if they wanted to, they'd have a business they could come into.
It was your idea to come up with a breakfast product.
Yeah, well, Hardee said you could put in breakfast, but they didn't say what it had to be.
Okay.
So we put it in. We had a few stores in Atlanta. And my supervisor down there told me, said, the next time you're down here, I want to show you something. So I was down there, and he said, come on, ride with me. So we went off out over the interstate. Pulled off to a little white wooden building. And I said, what is this? He said, come on, I want you to try something. And he said, biscuits. I said, biscuits? He said, yeah, try one. And I did. He said, they're good. I said, yeah, they're good. He said, well, how about let's put them in Hardee's? I said, biscuits in Hardee's.
Biscuits in Hardee's.
And he said, well, we got to do something. I said, you're right. So we put them in, and And we only had about 7 or 8 stores in Atlanta, so we didn't have the money to really market it. But we had about 16 to 20 in Tidewater, Norfolk, Virginia.
Right.
So I said, let's move it down there, which we did.
Okay.
And we made a little television on it about a lady coming in early in the morning.
Right.
And they just kind of took off, really did. They just, from the beginning. Well, it was just a super, and we could move it out fast.
Right.
And Hardee's didn't want to put it in But we kept it in. It was about 2 years before Hardy's ever put it in. Why, I don't know. Because we were making, you know, it was good revenue.
Mayo, we're here, as I said, at this beautiful home that you grew up, but it's expanded so much. You had the vision to expand Nathan Hall. Tell us about Nathan Hall.
Well, we were having, like I say, when I remodeled the house there, I had figured people said, what are you going to do with it? Because I knew that Gene wouldn't want to live out there. Well, the house is just too big, and I'm out of town right much. I used to be more than now. Anyway. So we started having, conferences, and some people asked me, what am I going to do with it? I said, I'll make a conference center. They said, what is a conference center? I said, I'm not sure, but we'll find out. So we started doing that, then we started getting requests for weddings. Right. And we started having a few, and I said, I don't want to turn this place into a carnival. But the weddings, of course, revenue, we needed some revenue.
Right.
And so after it got pretty, going pretty heavy, Donna Holt, who was the manager here, she kind of encouraged me to build Nathan's Hall, what is now Nathan's Hall. And she said, if we build it, they'll come. And
they did, Nathan.
Yeah, but it's doing real well, and we've got good management. Donna, she retired, and Walter is now general manager.
He was your executive chef. Yeah,
that's right.
And he's moved on up the ladder.
Yeah. He runs the whole thing. So it's real good, and most people get married out here at the gazebo, then they had the receptions in Nathan's Hall.
Right. Now, the house, I saw pictures of the gentleman's room in the house. Tell us about the gentleman's room.
Well, the gentleman's room was added on after we finished this. We finished this roughly 82, and then about four or five years later, I decided we needed a bigger room. What I call the gentleman's room. And so the house is hard pine, but the gentleman's room is mahogany. It came over in planks from, I forget where it came from, but there's a dealer in Tarpa that cut the board and the sidings and all. You'll see it when you go in, but it's all mahogany, it's real pretty. And so, like I say, I wanted to put a Jack Daniels bar in there, but Gene said, no, that wouldn't do. So, anyway, it's turned out real well. But one reason to build Nathan's Hall, too, I didn't want too much traffic in the main house.
Sure.
So, but we still, maybe a small wedding you might have inside, but most all of them out.
Right.
So it's worked out pretty good.
And you have the barbecue pit on
the property. Yeah, well, the barbecue pit. We just have cookers down there. And main thing, we only do cook down there with pigs. People want to cook out pig and whatever.
Right.
And
but it's very nice.
Yeah.
It's
just old. Well, the house was here originally, old pack house there, where they cured meat, hung meat in. And that set right out here. Right. So we moved that down there, and then we added the where the cookers are and all that. We added that on.
Okay.
So again, that's worked out well.
You've had several events.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Where they use the barbecue pit and have seafood. They've had seafood events out there and
have a catfish deal out there.
Yeah, the catfish, absolutely, with the soil and water, and the chamber has their event out there. Their lobster and shrimp every year event, and just many, many nice events out here. Now you're a big advocate of hunting and outdoors and wildlife, Mayo.
Yeah,
Have you always been?
Yeah. Well, I didn't hunt that much. I never hunted when I was little because my father didn't.
Okay.
But I always wanted to.
Okay.
And so when I got in a little better position, I started hunting. Then I got some friends, people that did hunt, they hunted overseas in different places. and I kind of got in with them, and we hunted a lot of places, you know, over in England, down in Mexico. We'd go down to Mexico every year for about 18 years, I reckon.
Wow.
Hunting quail mainly. Birds mainly what we'd hunt.
Now, you have sporting clays on the property. Tell us about that.
Well, we just, I had never shot a whole lot, and I wanted to get where I was a little better shot. And so we put in we didn't have sporting clays to begin with. We just had skeet, two houses, and the skeet come out the same way from each house, each stand. It's mm-hmm. the same thing. And so sporting clays was coming into its own, and I was reading about them, and Larry was too, so we put in, had a man here from, I think, South Carolina to set up a little course for us. And then after that, Larry kind of just really got involved in it and got it growing. And that's kind of Larry's baby.
Well, Larry Corbett is a world class.
Oh, yeah, Larry.
He's world class, yeah. Isn't he?
And you wouldn't know it because Larry didn't say much about it.
Right.
But we have a lot of young kids coming out in there from different schools. They compete.
Yes, you do.
Yeah, and Larry's really supporting that and getting that going. He's really done a lot down there. And, of course, on top of that, I bought the farm in June of 79, and he came with me in September of 79. So he's been here ever since and done a great job for me.
As you said, Mayo, your family lost during the Depression, lost this property, lost this farm.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Explain
mm-hmm.
how y'all were able to buy it back.
Well, I tell you, people said, I know you dreamed of buying it back. I said, no, I never thought that much about it because I never thought I'd be in any position. And we had some hardest going. And one day I was coming riding back from Fayetteville, and it just hit me for some reason, I don't know why, but that maybe I can put that deal together. Mr. Everett, who owned the farm, he had given it to Westland College, with the exception of the house and 16 acres. And Westland wouldn't do anything without Mr. Everett's blessings. And my brother Nick, and I believe Claude Mayo, had tried to buy it, but for some reason they couldn't get it together. I don't know what it was. And so I went, Mr. Everett was living in a Carlton House motel downtown. His wife, I think she was in a rest home. Anyway, so I'd get Mr. Everett, I'd drive him out here and ride him around the farm and show him how the land was wasting away. And of course they were renting it, but it was just run, the house was run down. And so I nurtured him for about 18 months, I reckon. And finally I told Mr. Everett I'd like to get the farm back if I could. And he had always told my father he'd like for the Boddies to get it back.
Right.
So he said, go ahead and talk to the school, see what you can do. So I did. And so they agreed to sell it, which they weren't in a position to do anything. That's when I got it back.
Well, sentimentally, how did you feel? What did that mean to you to be able to get this back?
Yeah. Well, it meant a great deal. I'm not, I didn't really get emotional over it. I mean, I was, because I thought about it a good while. And so I had just wished that my grandmother and my mother and father could see that we got it back.
You had known that you had
gotten it back.
Particularly
the conditions that they left under. Because Daddy said he had to borrow a truck to move what stuff we had out of here. You know, just didn't have anything on it.
Wow.
But, you know, we had back then in the 30s and early 40s, we didn't have much, but nobody had much.
Right, right.
And so we had a great life, great family, a lot of love.
And that's what counts.
That's right.
That's what counts, Matt.
A whole lot. But anyway, we were, like I said, I was very fortunate. We went to work right away. Sandy Liverman, she was a contractor.
Okay.
And she did a great job with it. Great job.
You're big in the Boy Scouts. Always have been.
Yeah. Oh,
were you a Boy Scout?
Was I a Boy Scout? Yeah.
Were you a Boy Scout?
Yeah.
Were you an Eagle Scout?
No. Nick was an Eagle.
Nick was an Eagle Scout.
You know, I said, you know why I didn't get Eagle?
Why is that?
Perfumes and gasoline. I had a a motorcycle, and I rode a lot, and I started dating Jean by that time. So Jean was the perfume, and the gasoline was my motorcycle. Yeah.
That's a great story.
Kind of took me out of the Boy Scouts temporarily, but when I got older, I got back involved, because it's just a good program, real good program.
You really did get back involved, and you've always supported the Boy Scouts.
And my three boys, my three boys, two of them are Eagles. My grand boys, all three of them are Eagles. So, and the Eagle is a good, and Nick was an Eagle. And it's a good program, you know.
Always have been involved in the community, always have given back. Mm-hmm. The Boddie family always has given back to the community. You've lived here, around here, most of your life, and have just always been there. When you think of our community, the Boddie name is just synonymous mm-hmm. with that. I mean, you think about the Boddie family.
Well, I think all that, you know, a lot of what you do comes from how you were raised. And my mother, particularly, she was just always doing, even though, you know, we didn't have much money-wise, but she was always making cakes or always doing something. Or sending us, I know, when we lived on Sunset, a man across from us got burned real bad in a boat accident. So she sent Nick and me over there every week to clean up his yard. Mm-hmm. Mow his grass, you know, whatever needed to be done. So
you were taught.
A lot of how we feel about that came mm-hmm. from my parents.
Right.
A whole lot did.
Very good.
And, you know, when you're successful to some degree, I think you have an obligation to the community or to different things around you. You know, that was just instilled in us.
Right.
And I hope Jean and I have done the same thing to our children, you know.
Bill is at the helm of Boddie Knoll now,
yeah,
but you're still very active.
Yeah, I'm going to stay active as long as I can.
Still very
well, I enjoy it. See, that's why, like I said before, if you're in business for yourself, if it's going to be successful, you got to have a passion for it. And ever since I got in Harders, from the first day we started Bill, I've had a passion for it. And I still do. And it's just a lot of fun. I like going around. We were down at Surf City yesterday, and the managers in there, they enjoy seeing you, you know. And I enjoy getting around. I just like to move around.
Well, I'm sure it means a lot that Mr. Boddie comes in and shakes their hand. And I want to talk about that, Mayo. You don't have a lot of turnover in your management, in your restaurants, mm-hmm. and even employees.
No, not a lot.
Because you treat your employees like family. It's like a big family.
Well, our philosophy or name is we believe in people. You know, and we do. Well, the people are the ones that make it go. Nick and I, when Nick was living, was sitting around, what we're doing, we don't make it go. It's the people out there. But they've got to want to do it. You know?
Right.
And what I tell our managers a lot, if you want people to respect you, the first thing you got to do is respect them. And if you respect them, you know, they'll get interested and they'll enjoy what they do because you're interested in them. You know, they're not just a number.
Right. You know? One of your philosophies is your management team has to go into a restaurant. Talk about that and work with a uniform.
Well, we were just talking about that the other day because we did that, and mm-hmm. we have stopped it. In fact, one of my grandsons, Bill Boddie, came at me and said, you know, y'all used to, top management used to go into restaurants and work, and I think we ought to start it up again. I said, Bill, you're right. We sure should. They go back, they said, the ones in the office said, we'll never complain about our job again. But people you take a biscuit maker, they get up, I talked to one and pour it over there. I said, what time you get up? She said, about 2:30 in the morning. And get some food ready for a child to go to school, et cetera. She gets at the store about 3:30 or 4. But she likes those hours. See, that
right.
that gives her, she gets off about, 11 or something, and then she's got the rest of the day. So before we got into it, people said, well, how are you going to get people to do that? But there are all kinds of people out here that like to do different things just
right.
because you don't want to work all night.
Right.
Doesn't mean they're not people to do. And they like it.
Very successful company. So you're doing things right.
Well, we've had our ups and downs, you know.
And every company does.
Yeah. And I'm sure in the future there'll be some more. But you have to, main thing, be prepared if some things do hit, and know what to do, and don't panic. And that's what I say. When things are good, I've never tried to get really elated about it, really excited. And when they're down, I don't really get down about it. I try to keep an even keel, you know. And your people want that. When things are down, they don't want top management dragging around, you know.
Right, exactly.
In fact, when things got bad, when was it? Sometime 10, 12 years ago, everybody was down, and so we had some buttons made up. No head dragging, no head drooping or butt dragging around here.
Wow, how neat. We could all use that button occasionally. Yeah. Where are they?
Yeah.
Wow.
So, and we meant it, and they perked right up, you know. But if top management is not positive and about what they're doing and keeping the right attitude, mm-hmm. the ones around
exactly.
you don't, you know. My philosophy is I'm firm, but I'm fair.
Well, Mayo, this has been wonderful. Mm-hmm.
Well, thank you. I've enjoyed talking to you.
And just a wonderful story, wonderful mm-hmm. success story, and motivational to others, mm-hmm. I hope, that want to be entrepreneurs.
Yeah.
Because your humble beginnings, it just shows that anybody can
but I say,
do it.
You've got to, I keep repeating it, I reckon, to you and others, you've got to have that passion. If you want to go in business for yourself, find something that you're really going to enjoy. Don't let it, when you get up every morning, be excited about going to work or doing what you're doing. And if you don't, find something you do. Life is too short to get up every morning and hate what you're doing. It's just too short. And you don't have to do it. But you have to take a few risks and do this and do that. And everybody's not going to want to do that, and that's fine. But too many people get hung up, get locked in security. Well, I was 40. I never got locked in security. But that was okay. And like I say, Jean, when I was making $4 to $5 a week, she didn't say anything. She never hardly questioned what I was doing, because halftime I didn't know.
She's been a wonderful partner, hasn't she?
Giving
you good advice. Now, she gave you good advice from the get-go about going into the military, didn't she?
Yeah.
She turned out to be right, didn't she?
Yeah, she did, which I really questioned that. But I did, and it worked out. So things will work out if you don't get too hung up or too excited or too down, you know, about it. Just kind of keep it even as you can.
Thank you so much.
Well, thank you.
For being with us.
Been
certainly
a pleasure.
Enjoyed it. Just certainly enjoyed being here at this beautiful facility where you were born. Thank you, Mayo.
All right. Thank you. Been
Have
a pleasure.
Have a great day.
Been a pleasure.